Yeah, when
I okay, gentlemen.
Okay.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the 14th episode of the ICO Cricket Show. I'm Satish Vishwanathan, your proud host. What a test match we had at Kanpur. A case of so near and yet so far for the Indians. You would think with a glance at the scoreboard, but dig a little deeper and you would know that the world test champions New Zealand had their chances too and could well have pulled off the improbable. Both teams have another chance to go at each other and to discuss what went on at Kanpur and what we can expect at the Wankhede Stadium in Mumbai from tomorrow, the rains relenting. I welcome with utmost pleasure the trio of Yajuvendra Singh Bilka, Jatin Paranjpe and K. Srinath. Yajuvendra, as Sunny as we fondly call him, as most of us would be aware, is a former India cricketer and middle order batsman with a world catching record. Currently, he serves on the ICA board as a member of the Thank you, Sunny, for making time for us yet again.
Thanks, Satish, to have me.
Jatin, a former Mumbai and India cricketer, has also been with us earlier. As a former national selector, he is very well placed to talk us through a possibly sticky selection issue that the Indian team has to reckon with while picking the 11 for the second test. Welcome, Jatin. I do hope the unseasoned rains relent and allow for the test to happen.
Yeah. Thanks, Satish. Thanks for having me. Looking forward to the chat.
Yeah. Our third panelist is someone I grew up with. We played most of our junior cricket together, post which he went on to both represent both Karnataka and Tamil Nadu at the senior level. That must have taken some doing, especially given the intense rivalry between the two states. Post his retirement from the first class scene, Srinath took up umpiring, which he is now seriously pursuing. Good to have you on board, Sri.
Thanks, Satish. Looking forward to having an enjoyable chat.
Yep. Sorry, I'll start with you. The test, yeah. You know, the Kanpur test couldn't have got any closer, could it? No.
Yeah, no.
Are you glad in a way that the wicket wasn't a raging turner and the fact that New Zealanders fought so well?
No, they did extremely well to survive. These are the things, that's what makes test cricket such an interesting feature, you know, in the thing. But more than anything, it's great fun because I'm the spectator now. We have a former selector and an umpire now. So they'll have many more things to say. But I think it's a fantastic achievement by New Zealand. So this will give them a lot of confidence because to be able to see, test cricket is not only about winning. It's also about not losing. And a draw at times was as important as anything. When we used to play, I remember in our times, we used to play the powerful Bombay side. We used to first look at, we have to draw the match more than anything else, you know, and it comes down to a state when teams are coming to India, it's becoming as important for them to draw the match, forget winning, at least drawing the match and not losing is becoming as important. Great, great performance by New Zealand.
Yeah, you know, this to quote Cricket Info, actually, since the start of 2013, India won 19 tosses in tests at home. And you know what happened when you win the toss? Apart from two weather-affected draws, they won 16 games. And only won by fewer than 100 runs. And this Kanpur, obviously, this is a kind of challenge, what New Zealand did and all that. But Jatin, you know, for all that the Kiwis fought, India's inability to close out the game must rankle, or am I being unfair? You know, we kept saying our attack doesn't depend on the pitch. But was this too slow a track that even if you beat the batters in the air, they had time to recover?
Satish, when I saw the pitch on the first morning and, you know, India won the toss. The first few balls which kind of kept low, I was a bit worried that, hey, here we go again. We are probably seeing a 2.5-3 day test match, which isn't good for cricket overall. But surprisingly, the pitch held, you know, the pitch held, the surface held, which shows that it's been rolled and watered enough. A pitch breaks, as Sunny Bhai and Sri would agree, a pitch breaks because of lack of watering, essentially. But the pitch held. But to answer your question, Satish, I thought there were missed opportunities for both the sides. I was a bit surprised with the captaincy by both leaders. I thought Kane Williamson also missed a trick, especially when Saha came into bat. I thought that he would get pace from both ends to try and get that quick wicket, because both Jameson they got a lot of bounce because of their height, and I thought Williamson kind of missed a trick there on the last day. And captains have their own frameworks in terms of how to approach games, and cricketers have their own viewpoints, and that's what makes this game fantastic, because you will think about it differently, Sunny Bhai will think about it differently, Shree will think about it differently, and I certainly would have opened on the fifth day with Akshar Patel, because the ball was new. As a captain, I've always thought that, you try and give, when the game has got to be forced, you try and give your best bowler as many runs to play with as possible. And also the fact that the ball was shiny. And I thought he would have had two or three overs from Akshar just to see what's happening. So I think both captains missed a trick. It was a fantastic test match, but I'm just thankful that the wicket held up.
Jatin has a point, but I have two questions for you actually, but I'll get to them one by one. The timing of the declaration, what are your thoughts? Our friend and the Indian coach, Rahul Dravid, defended the timing. And he pointed out, I think rightfully, that even 35, 40 minutes before they were actually declared, the test was severely poised and that the hosts are actually in a spot. Shri?
Yes, Satish. See, hindsight, I think, is a great teacher. Postmortem. It's very easy, to sit back once a game is done saying, what if, we had done it 15 or 20 minutes earlier. Mm-hmm. One thing Rahul would have kept in mind is about the light in Kanpur. We typically had play, being called off on every single day around about 4:25 and 4:30. So keeping that in mind, and maybe he might have had the thought in his mind going, saying that, the wicket could deteriorate much more on the final day. As Jatin put in, batting first, winning the toss, I think India maybe had another 50 runs in their kitty extra, and the lead would have become that much bigger for them. So a declaration could have been forced much earlier had India put up those many runs in their first innings. That is the point which I look at. I'm not going by what Rahul said and defending him, saying that, he defended the declaration part of it. Yes, even if I were to be in his seat there, certainly I would have taken a call at that point in time. Maybe they must have played about, say, 10 to 15 overs on day four, which didn't happen because of bad light. But I think 98 overs to bowl the New Zealand side out in the second innings on a wearing fifth day wicket was really a possibility. I won't point a finger and say that, there was a delayed declaration. That's also my point of view.
Okay. And Satish, if I may jump in here, now that you have the World Test Championship and every match counts for something, there is an added responsibility on teams to keep the points table in mind. So I think that would have kind of been a little bit of an incremental, factor in their decision to play on. It's easy to say that give them 240, 250, let's have a sporting declaration, but it can bite you on your back. So if I'd been in that position, I would have played exactly the same cards as India did.
Taking that further, is that, remember, our tail enders did pretty well. And, they batted well. The wicket didn't look as venomous as what one expected. So that was another thing, because you have Kane Williamson, you have a good New Zealand batting setup. And whether you wanted to take that chance. But as Shri said, there was enough time. I don't think time was a factor because, the tail enders played the last eight overs and they survived. So, we did time it perfectly in many ways. It's just that we didn't get the final wicket. That's it. I don't think declaration had such an important factor. One had to be safe as well.
Yeah. Sunny, actually, that you talked about the tail enders thing. Our top order actually was almost non-existent, right, in this. If not for Shreyas in both innings and the late and middle order, we'll come to the selection of the Mumbai test a little later. But that is a worry, isn't it? The performance in both innings, we were not able to, and on such a track.
Yeah, it is always a worry. But the good part is, we don't call them tail enders, basically middle order.
Late because, middle order is what I say. Yeah.
Yeah, because, Jadeja has been batting extremely well, and so is Ashwin. they have centuries under their belt. So, I mean, we can't just say that they are the tail enders, like what we used to call tail enders of, I don't want to name them because they'll all get very angry about it, because none of the tail enders ever think that they are tail enders. But yeah, our top order, somehow all of them, I don't think all of them are getting a big score. You know, one of them has to get a big score. They're not combining and getting us runs. I mean, Yatin would be a, he would be able to give us a little bit more being a selector, because it's quite a funny thing, because they're making runs, they're getting off the board. I mean, look at Rahane, he got 30 odd runs. Pujara looked good to get a lot of runs, but somehow things are not clicking for them. You know, nobody is being able to get a big score. I think that's the worrying part of it. Nobody is being able to take the team to that level of a 400 run or 450 run or something of that nature.
Yeah, that's what used to typically happen in India. Win the toss and we should easily put up those 450s and 500s. Sri, before I get Jatin to put his selector hat on, Sri, I wanted to put your umpiring hat on. You know, we were discussing offline. We saw a lot of decisions being reviewed and, you know, went both ways. How does an umpire look at it? From an umpire's point of view, what happens when you are given a decision and the completely reversed in time and again? What happens to the umpire?
Well, Satish, having played the game and then now donning the hat of an umpire, when I started off initially, I always felt that, you know, I had the cutting edge, saying that because being a player, having been at the receiving end many a times and, you know, having just passed the umpire also at certain point in time, thought that it would be a very easy job. I mean, I always connect umpiring to cricket. It's again a form game. Like, you know, we've got two former great cricketers who would agree with me. It's the first ball, whether you play it in the middle of the bat or you judge it well to see it pass to the keeper, your eye is in, you're there. It's the same thing for an umpire. You know, there's an appeal in the first three or four balls of an innings and you get it right, your confidence level goes up. You miss something at that point in time, there is the monkey still, you know, lingering onto your back and saying that, when do I get off this? But yes, it's about mindset. I don't want to get into management theory, saying that how would you just get yourself back in the groove after having made an error? It's very easy to explain, saying that, okay, there is DRS, which has come in recently in the last 10, 12 years, and which is going to rule the roost, and technology is going to get that much bigger in the days to come by. For an umpire, he is under the scrutiny. Just for the viewers, perspective, I'll just give them a heads up, saying there are 36 cameras that are used in an international game. So an umpire can miss 35, but one camera will certainly catch him. So it's like saying, you know, the simple thing is, naked eye, people can say that, you know, it just missed by a whisker. But when you see the replay, it would show that it's missed, you know, by about 6 or 7 stumps. So nowadays, what has happened is a criticism that is coming. It's called as armchair umpiring. People say, why is the third umpire taking so much of time to make this decision? So he's in the box, he's paid to do a job, and he's paid to do a job to get the right decision every time. It's not just that, you know, he gets one right and he misses the other one. No, he's not supposed to do that, because he's got technology to support him. Yeah. And this particular game, I would say, like the cricketers, they were of hibernation. Jatin would agree. The second half of IPL, post that we played the T20 World Cup, the last test match both the teams played was quite some time ago. India played in England and New Zealand also came off the World Cup. So we always perceive, saying that, you know, cricketers are superhumans. They need to adapt from formats to formats very easily. The performance levels have to go up. It's the same for an umpire also. To stand in a 20-over game, I won't say it's that much easier, but his focus levels are there. It's intense. He gets in and gets out that much quickly. Whereas over a period of 5 days, it's 450 hours of cricket. It's as difficult. And mind you, a batsman can score runs. He can go sit back and relax after he gets out. It's the same for a bowler. He can bowl a spell, team is all out, they get a time to put up the field. But the only two guys who are out in the middle throughout the 5 days are the two umpires. So it is that much more challenging than them. And as we were discussing, Sunny was telling offline that how strenuous the umpiring job has become today. Well, I would always say it's the challenge and passion. I always believe that you have the best seat in the ground to watch your great cricketers perform. You sit in the pavilion, you sit in a, you know, comm box, you sit elsewhere in the press box, you watch cricket from a long view, or you sit in the television, you get different angles. But the best place and best seat in the house for you is to be an umpire and stand there and watch it. So the job is tough. Yes, of course. Like wicket keeping, like fast bowling, like spin bowling. It's tough. We all get into that by choice. So if somebody comes and says that, you know, it's a very tough job and challenging, it's not that easy, you guys, I don't buy that argument at all. If I'm an umpire today, I'm by choice. So I need to put my head on the chopping board saying that if there is criticism, I've made an error, I have to accept that and move forward. So I think DRS in that count has done wonders. When you know that you've made a decision, it's been reversed, you do this. It's just like saying, I'm sorry, I got it wrong. We move forward, the best decision has been made. I think that's the simplest way to convey it. And as cricketers make errors, they make mistakes, they play bad shots, they don't bowl in the right areas at the right times. They go back, they have an analyst, they go through all those things on the videos and say, yes, we need to correct these things. The preparation of an umpire also is the same. He knows what his strengths are. In fact, when we go for the pre-match inspection, we also have a look at the wicket and try and talk to the curator saying, how would this wicket behave? What sort of results are you looking at it? Like Jatin said, this game held on for 5 days. When I started watching the game, I thought it would be another 3.5 day one. Yeah, so you start setting your mind for that also.
Yeah. Yeah, Sri, you know, what we need to do is I think we need to have a separate show on this DRS.
Yeah, we'll do that. We'll
get 2-3 of your umpires.
Yeah.
It's very interesting. A lot of people don't know, you know, what happens, what the process is and all that.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's great insight, Sri. Jatin, now the big question. Mumbai, no, two questions actually. First, will the rain stop?
I think he's muted.
You're muted.
Sorry, Satish. It's still raining as we speak. Mm-hmm. And it's rained all night long. I don't see a on-time start tomorrow at all. The Met department is saying that it's going to rain moderately or with intense spells today as well. So honestly, it's going to be a little bit of a challenge. I think it could be one of those situations where losing the toss is probably the better option. So because you don't know how much the covers have sweated, the ground has been covered for a while. Let's not forget that there's not been a lot of cricket at the Wankhede. So I, even though I know the pitch a little bit, I don't want to hazard a guess on what will happen. I feel that it will be a little bit of a sporting wicket. You will see the seamers having a good time as well. Is my initial thought on it. So I think we're looking at a delayed start tomorrow, Satish.
Okay. And as and when the game starts, Jatin, who are we going to drop to bring in Virat Kohli? You know.
Yes.
There are a lot of theories going around. We're talking about.
Don't put him under selection again.
he's being very humble by saying he knows the Mumbai pitch a little bit. That's been, humility to the core. He's played all his cricket lifelong in Mumbai.
I know the saying of like the back of my hand, that's all crap because you don't know the back of my hand.
Correct.
He certainly knows the Mumbai pitch. So Jatin, you know, lot of the latest theory is that Bharat could open if Sahar got fit. Bharat is actually 77 of his 123 first class games. He's open. And obviously, drop one of these either Mayank or Shubman Gill and not the big two, you know, Cheteshwar or Rahane. And incidentally, if Rahane plays, I'm sure he'll play. It's going to be his first home test. He's never played in the Wankhede. So he can't say backyard and things like that as far as test is concerned. So what would you do? I mean, if you were to pick 11.
So if we take a step back, Satish, it's let's look at the framework on which this Indian team works. There is obviously form and the number of runs you've scored in the last 12 games, and you're seeing numbers with calendar year 21 numbers for Ajinkya Rahane are not impressive, although he scored 100 in Australia. But I think the framework of this Indian team lends a lot of weightage on experience. Satish. So I see that Ajinkya Rahane will play. They will juggle the batting order a little bit to either Saha or Bharat opening the batting. But the real big and tough decisions lay 4 weeks down the road in South Africa. That's where a call will have to be taken because Rohit Sharma will be back. So that's where the call will be taken. I think Ajinkya Rahane will get another chance to play. And I hope he goes and plays freely because that's something which has been missing from Ajinkya's game for a while now. The troubling part for me is that over the last few years, you haven't really seen him, display the intent which his 100 at Lord's or the Johannesburg 96 innings showed. He got a 100 in each innings against South Africa and Delhi, if I'm not mistaken, which was on a rank turner again. But I'm seeing some intent missing. So if you go back to the framework of the Indian team, there is experience, but intent is also extremely important. So especially with Rahul Dravid being there, intent will become even more important. So he's got one chance with two outings to show that, hey, he can still do the job. I'm confident that he can do the job. He's played at the 1K day hundreds of times, so that will go in his favor as well. But he will play. He will play, and the keeper will open. Is my thought on it.
Yeah, Shri. But Ashreem, just one thing I want to get out of the way with you. We had this. You said, we take a step back. The policy that the Indian team had is if a regular member of the 11 was missing for whatever reason, through injury or whatever, then whoever has taken his place goes out, irrespective of what he does. Like a Karun Nair 100. Rahane came back, which is it was a call that was made on a calculated basis. So it gives very little cause for complaint. But so similarly, then it is Shreyas Iyer, who, despite the fantastic stuff that he did at Kanpur, but would you look at it or would you ignore that part because whatever reason?
I would ignore that part in this particular instance because he's probably scored 60 to 65% of all the runs India have scored in the last Test match. So he's in form. And the other factor which goes in his favor is that he's a local boy. He knows the 1K day well. He knows the 1K day pitch well enough. And I feel they will go in with him just because he's the man in form. Take it from there on.
I think Satish,
yeah.
Satish, coming to it, I don't think the Karun Nair thing was a very fair incident. And I don't think we should repeat it again. Okay, it was one sort of a thing that happened. But the way Iyer is playing, I mean, it will be a folly to not include him in the side. Coming to, again, Rahane and Pujara, I think even if Bharat is going to play an open or Saha, whatever, I would rather open with one of these people. I would rather open with Rahane or Pujara. Because they have to be there. They're great players. They're very, very good players. They can't become bad players. And Rahane, like I said, the 35 he made, he looked very good. And so did Pujara in the second innings, the 20-odd. See, you can get out. It was just a nick on the leg side or whatever. That can happen. But they both didn't look out of form by any imagination. So I would rather use them as an opener. And it's happened in Indian cricket very often, that players have been used at the top to go along to accommodate them. And I think we have to do that for at least to Rahane. I would love to see him playing a test match in Bombay, and especially the amount of service he's given to Indian cricket. He deserves it more than anything else.
Shri?
Yeah, I think I'm happy to agree with Sunny. History is not repeating itself. Should not, rather. A guy like Karun got a 100. Is just, shunted out of the playing 11 and Rahane walks in to replace him. Whatever was the policy of the team at that point in time will certainly not hold good now. Yes, Shreyas Iyer has to play. And I'm a firm believer that, Rahane should play. Like, I have umpired many number of games in Wankhede in Mumbai. I wouldn't say back of my hand like Jatin knows, but I have known Wankhede Stadium good enough. So certainly, I mean, I would agree with all the points. But my only question to Jatin is, even Sunny said about Pujara, Rahane's contribution to Indian cricket. We've had past greats like, Lakshman, Rahul, Sachin. All of them contributed handsomely. Handsomely is a very small word to use. And a time had come wherein people had to be judged on what they were doing on current form. So now the yardsticks to judge players, yes, will be different. Pujara is 90 test match old. Rahane is 78 test matches old. They have spent enough time under the sun. They know the venues across the world really very well. Now, how much longer a rope would you give them beyond these last two seasons? Yes, Jatin said, Rahane made a wonderful 100 in Australia. Memory is very short. We just forget that. Yes, and as a captain, did a wonderful job in Australia after Virat left. And even Pujara, yes, when out of form, Sunny, I always believed, I could be wrong also, you get out in really such fashions, getting down the leg, caught down the leg, run out, all these things will happen when the rub of the green is not going your way. But I think somewhere, because you have a tour that is happening in Australia now, we spoke about Rohit Sharma coming back. There is going to be KL Rahul who's going to be coming back. There is Prithvi Shaw. There is Vihari who's knocking on the doors for a middle order. I feel he's been the most unluckiest cricketer. He's not played a single test game in India. Mind you, Iyer, I've done enough of his games. I've seen him in very close quarters. He's a fantastic cricketer, no doubt. He was lucky enough to make his debut in India, in Kanpur, wherein, you know, typically it's not like baptism by fire. Those days, Sunny would agree with that. You know, making your debut in the West Indies against the quartet of fast bowlers without your headgear, whatever. So I think I am a believer. I could be wrong. People could prove me wrong also. Somewhere the message has to go out to Pujara and Rahane saying, yes, time has come. It's like a time bomb ticking for them. Whatever they have done in the past is history now. They have to get their best foot out there and say, yes, we are there for this reason. That is my call. And I certainly believe that there should be only one change for the Wankhede test match. It should be Virat coming in. And, you know, unfortunate, again, this word hangs on Mayank's head now, because he's been a proven cricketer. If I would go, it's just not the Karnataka connection. Maybe even Shubman Gill has come back after an injury. He's not played that much of cricket. In fact, Mayank was in roaring form in the IPL. Option could be even you could leave out Shubman, you know, open with Bharat, who's done wonderfully well in first-class cricket and is a proven keeper, has really done well, subject to the fitness of, you know, Vridhim and Saha. Rest otherwise, the bowling remains the same.
Chetan?
I think when you had the big four being phased out of the Indian team, there were three or four other players who were kind of knocking on that door very, very hard. And it's the similar case here. You, like Shri said, you have KL out right now. You have Rohit out right now. You have Vihari, who's been extremely unfortunate. You have Shreyas Iyer, who's made 100 in his first game. You have Prithvi Shaw. So I think there are lots of questions to be answered, for this Indian team. I think most of these questions are more the 30,000 feet kind of questions, that where do we want to go as a team from here? And that's where I genuinely feel somebody like Rahul Dravid is just the right guy to be in charge, because he can look at the big picture. He understands the big picture very, very well. He knows the capabilities of all these four or five players who are waiting in the wings. And one thing which you can be rest assured with Rahul, I've known him for a long time, since our under 17 days, but in the recent past, I've seen him handle the NCA, handle India A, and also look after India under 19. One thing which you will get from Rahul Dravid is transparency. He will without a shadow of a doubt, with utmost clarity, explain to the players that need explaining in terms of what their roles are, what the team expects from them. And there would be no shadow boxing on that front. He will communicate the message politely, but the message would be communicated with clarity. So, like I said, the real questions for the Indian team as they embark on a new chapter under Rahul Dravid are not around the Wankhede test match. It's around what will come in January with South Africa. I think that's where you could see a change in direction. Not only in the test team, but also in the T20 team. I expect a lot of changes in the T20 team, to be honest with you. So there are questions, but these are all good problems, you know, because you have a pipeline of fast bowlers, you have a pipeline of batsmen. These are all good problems to have. Good problems are, good problems doesn't mean they aren't tough ones. These are tough problems which need to be solved. And somewhere I think the selectors and the coach are the foremost decision makers in this process, because you also have fluidity around the white ball and the red ball captaincy. So these are all problems which need to be solved. I have a feeling that this situation would be communicated very, very clearly to those whom it needs to be spoken about. But there are challenges in front of us for sure. Good challenges, but challenges all the same.
You know, Jatin, one correction here. The test series against South Africa, December 17th is the first test.
December 17th is the first test. And then came on the second end of Jan.
Correct. Yeah. We were supposed to announce the team yesterday, immediately after the Kanpur test. But because of uncertainty on the tour, they put it off. So, I mean, that's the biggest challenge. I agree, because we have to look at this test and keep South Africa in mind. So, and if you drop a Pujara or a Rahane, their career is over. It's not, I don't think they have enough time to come back and things like that. So the decision becomes even more tougher, but that's what these guys are there for.
And Satish, if I might add one more point, like I mentioned earlier, you overlay all these decisions with the fact that you're playing for a World Test Championship. You know, so that becomes another factor. I wouldn't be surprised if they still went with experience for South Africa. Now you can carry a bigger squad. So those questions are more about picking the 11 than picking the squad, because you're going to take 20 or 22 players there. Yeah. So that offers because of the COVID situation. And I don't know whether that series will happen, you know, because the new strain has emerged from Southern Africa. It's going to be a very, very big call as to whether the series will happen. Keep that aside for a second. I think that the if I had to gaze into a crystal ball, they'll carry a big squad, but they will still go with experience in South Africa, probably give one or two test matches more to both Pujara and Rahane. And if it doesn't unfold there, then they will unbox a couple of new players or go back to the three or four we spoke about.
Yeah, the bio bubble has been quite an advantage to a lot of players, because you can take a big chunk of players with you and then decide at that time. So even if they go, that thing is going to be a very, very strict bio bubble secured sort of environment. They're not going to let anyone go anywhere at all. I think South Africa, yesterday's paper quite clearly mentions that India has accepted to go there. South Africa desperately needs it for you know why. Yeah. I mean, officially it is going to give them some money at least. Otherwise, they had an Australian tour which was cancelled. So I think everyone's going to try and make it such that the tour does get going. But just coming to both of you and all of you, is what happens, I mean, we are talking about the batsmen and we are talking about the two top batsmen and whether they should be in the side. But what about Aksar? I mean, will he play? Will they play with three spinners? And if not, who's going to get dropped? I mean, that's going to be interesting. Whether the combination remain the same with two fast bowlers and three spinners. Because I don't think you can drop Aksar every time. I mean, it's not fair to someone who's got five times in four test matches, five wickets on five occasions. That's going to be another, and especially as Jatin said, the wicket will be a little, it will help the seamers. It does help in Bombay anyway. They may remove the grass, but because of the moisture.
So they've removed it already, sorry. Today it's gone.
Sorry, Satish?
The grass has already been removed.
No, but that 1 millimeter comes along. But remember, there's always a little movement in Bombay. So pacer does come into play out there. And with this sort of this rain, you will not be able to get a dry wicket. It's going to be difficult because it is seeped into the ground. So it's not going to be that easy to get a dry, crumbling wicket. They would have to use a dryer to do that.
Yeah, that's a tough call to agree. I mean, New Zealand have to do the same thing, right? They have to, I think Vettori has already called for Wagner to come in three. He's saying that, I think Sawyer will or somebody will go out because they want their batting also, Rachin Ravindra brings in that little bit of batting element. So both teams have this call to make, whether to play a New Zealand is easier, I think, than India.
Yeah. I think the visiting teams always get sucked into this, the culture of saying we need to play that many spinners. I think, I don't know which was the former cricketer who made that statement. I think teams need to play to their strengths. I think one team which I've always seen is Australia. They've even played with three seamers on a chip-off wicket. I've seen that, you know. They had Gillespie, Kasprovich, and I think McGrath. So, I believe, Kane Williamson was posed with this question in the post-match conference saying that, did they miss Neil Wagner? Again, you know, looking at the composition of the wicket, they might have thought, you know, three spinners would have been good. And to be honest, not mincing my words, certainly by no stretch of imagination, neither Somerville or, Patel, they look like guys who are going to run through an Indian side even on a ranked turner. That's something you really, you know, are looking for a very big thing. As you know, we were talking about the Mumbai wicket, but whatever I have seen, I think the first day, I think first couple of hours, definitely the seamers are going to have a ball. And, you know, the way Jamieson and Saudi bowled, with the experience Saudi has got, and the stark difference between somebody like, you know, Jamieson and Ishan Sharma was. I mean, Jamieson used the short ball to good effect on the Kanpur wicket. Wherein on a slow wicket where there's not that much bounce, Jatin would agree, when you're trying to bowl short, you know, taking the pace of the ball, the batsman is in two minds. In fact, Shreyas Iyer got out to such a shot in the second innings. Yeah. After he played the shot down the leg, he was caught. I don't think the Indian seamers tried to use the short ball to that much effect there. So certainly Wagner would be a guy running in for a place in the playing 11. And Mumbai wicket always has been the best. Second day has been the best time to bat on Jatin. You know, make hay while the sun shines. I think day two has been fantastic to bat on. And day three, four, five, certainly, you know, with the red soil texture, you get a bounce and turn on the wicket. And I think all three different types of bowlers we got to the Indian side. Ashwin is somebody who's wily. He can turn the ball. He can get bounce. Akshar is somebody who's accurate again, you know, who can get good bounce. And Jadeja, of course, he brings in two dimensions into the game. Sorry, three dimensions. So I think I don't see Akshar missing out on this. It would be a case of Virat comes in and who goes out will be the only question. And as far as New Zealand is concerned, I would, I feel that it would be Wagner who would be making the playing 11 ahead of Somerville. That's my take.
But yeah. What about in our side? Is Ishan Sharma or is it going to be Mohammad Siraj? I mean,
Sunny bhai, I was just going to answer that. I think there will be a change in the Indian bowling lineup because that will be, as you said, Mohammad Siraj probably will come in for Ishan. I think Paras Mamre, the bowling coach today, has made a statement saying that Ishan Sharma is still not bowling in, you know, to his full rhythm and he needs a few games. And when you have two fast bowlers, Sunny bhai, as you very well know, you need both those guys firing on all cylinders. You know, and Mohammad Siraj is a guy who will keep attacking the stumps all the time. He's a wicket taker. I have a lot of time for him as a cricketer. So I think there will be a change. I think they will probably leave Ishant out, play Mohammad Siraj. There's no question of dropping Akshar. Because at the 1K day, Nilesh Kulkarni took a lot of wickets at the 1K day because of the bounce. And Akshar gets a lot of bounce. So you will see bat pad coming into play. So this, if to my mind, I think it's Akshar. Akshar is probably right up there in terms of playing in the 11.
But what I found very funny was that Mayank fielding at Gully in his knees. I mean, was he playing French cricket or what? I mean, you're just out of balance. You can play that kid stuff. That is really when you talk about somebody. Your father would have really taken the pants out of him for sitting like that on his haunches, hoping to catch a ball. I mean, what was he trying? It's just you have to bend down. You have to be really, really down. You have to be down. That's it. That's what Indian cricket was all about when we were catching. You had to keep low.
Stay low, and
your hands are low. Your body can't be low. I mean, you can't be sitting on your haunches to get a catch. I mean, that was ridiculous. I couldn't believe somebody at this stage would be playing French cricket out there. But now, I don't know, modern cricket, you all could answer it better.
I think he could be only catching what came to him directly. 1 feet either side, I think he couldn't move because there's no mobility in where he is.
Yeah.
As you said, nobody better than you. I mean, staying low is the key for anybody who's in close in. So I think he's not going to be mobile at all, you know, sitting on his knees there.
And I would, if that had played a reverse sweep, I don't know what would have happened to him.
Anyway, gentlemen, as usual, it's been an absolute pleasure having you all on this show. I think you've got a lot of very interesting points. As I said, we've got a topic for another show with three and probably get a couple of umpires in. We'll have one non-umpire also to argue, you know, we can't let them get away with. I'm a non-umpire in any case. So what I've enjoyed, what a little umpiring I've did. But again, it's absolute pleasure having all three of you. Thank you for your views. I'm sure our audience, the wonderful audience, who also I thank for joining us, would have enjoyed this show. Our secretary, Hitesh, sends a message thanking the three of you. His personal message I'm just passing on. And hope to have you guys back sometime in the near future. And good luck to Indian cricket. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thanks, Satish.
Thank you, Satish. Thank you so much. Yeah. Bye-bye.